Hello and welcome to Hazard and Hope. I'm Ed, and in this episode of Our Flood Resilient Home, we're heading to the city of York to meet Selena and hear about how flooding's affected her home and the variety of different ways that her and her family have adapted their property to make it more flood resilient. So here we go. This episode of Hazard and Hope is sponsored by Flood Re.
It was three cottages initially, one at One Down, Yorkshire Cottages, and then it became a pub, and then it became a property. So we flooded first of all in September 2012, then we flooded again in the Boxing Day floods of 2015. In the 1950s, there was a landfill put on the site outside, and actually they left the house in a dip. So the water actually makes us into a bit of a lake. There's a tipping point, it comes over 4.7 metres, and that will tip us over. But both of the other floods were about 5.2 metres. And so once it comes. And then, as I say, we sort of sit in it for a few days.
You'd never been in a flood before, is that right?
No.
You've not seen one?
No. I was picking up the kids from school and a friend said, have you seen the river levels? And I said, no, I don't think that's going to affect us. And she said, really? Kind of, you need to take a look. And I think it might. So I came home and we started looking and then realised that it was set to peak at over 5 metres, and sort of thought, whoa, that is above what we've been told we will flood at. So we went to stay with friends that night, and then at 8 o'clock in the morning, Peter came down and came back, and there'd been a little bit of a feeling the night before that, you know, we were slightly over, you know, being over dramatic about it. Then Peter came back and said, no, we flooded and it's serious. So we sort of downplayed it, got the kids to school and got sort of rid of them, and then we're like, oh. So Peter and I came down, and yeah, it's just a huge shock to see your house suddenly, as you know, in a murky pond, really. Very hard to see children's toys just sort of floating in the water. We lost a folder that nursery had put together of my son's, you know, activities and what he'd done, and that was ruined. Just quite a shock to see. Yeah, I think it was the kids' stuff that really was hard, and just to see sort of life possessions piled up in a sort of a heap outside was really tricky. And initially we were trying to look, as I said, for short-term lets, because we thought it would just be a matter of a few weeks. And then we were sort of, you know, told, no, it's going to be longer than that. You're looking at a 6-month property let. Obviously we called the insurers. And then, as I say, your brain is just freezing, really. I remember being utterly exhausted and feeling oddly like we were temporarily homeless. And, you know, whilst friends, of course, are very, very willing to say, you know, come and sit in ours and make phone calls, it's really not the same. You know, however lovely they are, it's very odd not having that private space that's your home to be able to discuss something important. Feels very strange. Not least, we had to sort of collect the kids from school, and you know, there was sort of immediate plans and then longer term plans. And
well, how long were you out for in total?
It was about 6 months.
It's amazing how long it can take to dry out a building, to dry out its walls, and how much moisture.
Absolutely. So it's a full 12 weeks. So the whole house downstairs was filled with the industrial dehumidifiers, which are incredibly noisy, and it felt like forever. I mean, literally the work didn't start for 3 months, because it can't, because it's damp.
Did you think about putting it back in a more resilient way?
Yeah, yes and no. We were fortunate enough to have insurance, and that made a huge difference. This floor, for example, in the dining room was the original Victorian floor, and it popped. So the insurers redid this floor, and of course they did it into modern standard, so the water wouldn't come through this floor. The rest of the ground floor, though, of course, they didn't do. Still, you knew you had sort of pockets of weakness. All of the electric sockets were raised after that first flood. Possibly not that much more, to be honest with you. There was a little bit of a sense of it's once in 100 years, and we sort of thought that was awful, but it's 100 years. And it was actually then when we flooded again, and then my mindset was entirely different, and it was all about resilience. So I was a little bit slow off the mark, to be honest with you. We should have reacted after the first one.
Fast forwarding on to the Boxing Day 2015 floods.
It was Boxing Day evening. We were watching Downton Abbey, and we got pinged like half a dozen times, and I sort of ignored the first few, and then it was like, actually, no, not that many people are ringing us at exactly the same time, and it was various friends who were saying, have you seen? We've got a big party organised the following day, and it was Boxing Day night. I mean, we were in the throes of Christmas. We had some very, very lovely friends who came and helped. We got the kids out of bed, and it just felt, to be doing a midnight evacuation was just awful. We all woke up early the next morning and walked down, and it was dry. And we were like, oh, maybe it's going to be okay. And literally, as we were saying that, Peter and my son had gone to the end of the gate and had looked out, and they literally saw the water coming. So it literally broke its bank sort of as we were here. And the way that it does is it breaks the banks over the Millennium Bridge and then it comes up. So you literally had two torrents of water coming. So I said to the kids, you've got 15 minutes. Get in, go grab any Christmas presents you want, just grab as much as you can. We sort of filled the car. The kids quickly didn't want to be around. We sort of watched it come ring really. There was a silly sort of sick fascination at one point of just sort of seeing what was happening. But it was interesting to watch, because I think previously the water had just arrived. And it was interesting to sort of see, for example, where the weak points were coming through the walls, whatever. I think we were quicker off the mark to know, we knew we needed a 6 month property, there was no messing about, but there was a feeling of quite difficult inactivity. It was Christmas, so a lot of people were closed, the estate agents say were underwater. So I think we were in something like, 10 properties over 13 days, sort of, a night at a friend's house. Somebody had an Airbnb that we could go and stay in for a few days. Somebody was on holiday for a new year. So we, it was really, really tricky and quite tiring to live out of a suitcase that much. And obviously utterly exhausting over Christmas. You were not getting a break in any way, shape or form.
Did the measures you had changed after the first flood sort of work after the second?
It was slightly easier to clean up, but I don't think, the measures that we've put in now after the second flood are so much more, almost every room downstairs has been adapted. We were given help through the Environment Agency grant to put in the doors, and that they look amazing. And yeah, fingers crossed, they will be a huge resilient measure. After the second flood, we got the living room floor done in a sort of the modern, proper way of doing a floor sheet. So that should be more resistant. We haven't had a flood since, so I don't know what the outcome's going to be. But I'm so much more confident that what we've done will not necessarily keep the water out completely, but it will massively help. I think it will reduce the level of the water, and I think it will therefore increase the ability to recover. My whole thinking of working through the recovery was, where's the areas that it takes time and what can be done to reduce that time? So I think the promise to the kids was, we might have to be out for a few days. There might have to be that initial cleanup, but we're not going to move out for 6 months again. And how can we make that happen? How can we live in a property and go through it, but be here?
What have you got the time down to now if you needed to prepare and adapt?
Prepare and adapt. A couple of hours, I think. So we did do a full sort of flood preparation in February 2020. And that was quite good, because it was one of those things that we'd put it in place. And then, of course, we kept saying, really, you ought to test it out. And of course, you never quite get round to it. So it was, the first time we did it, it was quite good. I could have done with not doing it 4 weekends on a row, because that was a little bit of an overkill. We did write down what we did, and we did write down the order that we did it and what needed to be done. You'll see when we go through, it's not that straightforward. So this is the room that floods the most. So it reaches up to the windowsill, actually. So it comes in sort of from the Millennium Bridge that side, and then from Germany back that side. And this is the room that sort of fills up most. So the very clever things that we've done in this room, which is not our idea, but somebody mentioned it to us. All of these are on hinges, if you can see. So they lift up and they have aluminium legs that pull down. It's a very solid, very heavy
Trestle table.
Wow. So you can get the sofas up on there, really?
Yes,
wow.
Yes.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
And it goes all the way around.
There's a lot of stuff you simply can't get upstairs. Yeah. Everything else, you got upstairs, and then after the flood, for 6 months, you can barely get up the stairs because it's just full of everything.
The settee that we bought, we chose it very specifically because it can just be lifted up and off so that you're just sort of lifting and again, the settee can be moved in sort of an easy layer. The sockets are all raised up on high. The furniture, we've got two pine chest of drawers. We might have time to move them, we might not. At the end of the day, they're pine chest of drawers, they'll be fine. And in the corner, we've now got sort of albums and sort of important things raised up high, and a very, very lightweight piano that can also be lifted very easily. We made the decision to have the fireplace that goes through, but we also made the decision to raise the fireplace as well. The doors that we've got are very clever. So basically they lift off, and that means that you can just put them on somewhere safe, and once everything's clean, you're just putting the door straight back in. So in here we made the decision that we were going to put up tiles, so we might lose the wood outside, but that's not the end of the world to get those replaced. But the idea is that we can sanitize and it's done. The furniture's lighter again, and if we go through to the kitchen. So this is the internal barrier, and this is probably the most obtrusive thing we've got in the house, and it's, I don't think anybody's ever noticed it really, but so this is our internal barrier. This door also lifts out. This floor is old. It's effectively the old Victorian floor. It's just got a pretense that it's the same modern floor as everywhere else. So I suspect that this is where the flood would come through, but we have a pump now. So the idea is that we would stop the water coming through. We've got a powerful pump that would go straight out of the window. We also switched to a stainless steel kitchen, and it should just be a case of wiping it down and sanitizing it. That's my hope really. The cooker is raised up. We went for a bamboo worktop. So we've raised the washing machine, the tumble dryer up off the ground. It's one less thing to have to replace, one less thing to worry about, really. Flood doors are all stored in there. What they said to do was just sort of check for, check the seals there. Slip in like that, and then you lift these up. It goes in there. Oh, there we go, and then that seals it. There are things like non-return valves on various of the water outlets to stop flood water going back. So they put on a seal on the outside, which was supposed to just help the brick, stop a lot of moisture going through.
In terms of insurance for the home, how's that being in relation to the flooding?
So we were insured after the first flood, and they very kindly insured us again. We couldn't quite believe it when we rang them up. Anyway, after the second flood, they thought better of it and didn't want to reinsure us. But by that time, flood re had happened, which was brilliant. And we got, personal flood insurance through flood re, which by memory was sort of pretty much what we'd expect to pay. It wasn't anything excessive.
The cost of reinstatement for the first flood and the second flood, what was the...
Remarkably similar. I mean, really freakishly similar.
And was it, so it was tens of thousands, or was it kind
of...
Close to
100,000.
Was some of that money put towards the tiles up the wall, a few different...
Yeah, so that's building and contents. So there was a certain amount of contents that... There's certain contents that I think you're just going to lose. The fridge and the dishwasher, I can't do anything to save that. That's just going to have to be written off. But there are costs when I look at the contents that we lost in both floods that we won't lose next time. If we're here and we can put the plan in place, we won't lose them next time. So I'd expect the contents to be less.
With some of the approaches you've got in now, if that water level's being kept lower than the actual damage to the walls, to the fabric,
that's
to all
the
these
hope.
Other things.
Yeah, that's very, very much the hope. So I think that the issue of having a meter of water in your house is just, how far up you know, furniture and walls and things that it gets. But now, if you've got time to put the flood plan in place, as I say, there are things that you will need some support with, but the cost should be dramatically, dramatically less. And there's both in terms of financial cost and in terms of time out of the house cost, both should be dramatically reduced.
Are there any things, if you were sharing sort of your experiences and thoughts and recommendations for somebody who maybe might flood or has never flooded before but could flood, what would you want to say to them? What would you recommend they think about?
Well, I think resilience quicker. I think get into your mindset that it doesn't really alter in lots of ways. I would say the house has been enhanced by the resilience measures. It's not something that you have to sort of feel is going to alter the aesthetic of your house. You know, it's not gonna change that. It might be a nice thing to think about. And I think also you can start to think about these things just when you're getting other work done. You know, you can just start to think, well, actually, you know, would it do any harm to raise the electric sockets up? My word, that saves you such a lot of effort when you know, if it happens, that you can immediately put your electrics back on is actually a pretty huge thing to have. I mean, we initially had carpet, for example, in the living room. We'd replace the carpet and then we flooded again. This is crazy, let's not have a carpet in the living room. But we've put underfloor heating in the living room. So actually, although it's tiled and there's rugs, there's underfloor heating, so it feels lovely. I'm not saying everybody has to do that, but it just, there are things that you can do that I don't feel, you know, 99.9% of our time living here isn't anything to do with floods. So, you know, I don't feel that it's lost out.
I suppose following on from that, have you noticed that the measures and the ways that you've adapted the house to be more flood resilient have had an impact on the well-being of you, yourself and your family?
I think it has. You know, I don't think you could live here if you were going to be in a permanent state of panic every time it rains. This isn't the house for you. We don't live in that state, and we don't live in a permanent state of panic. At the same time, we are aware that it might happen again. But I think the message very much to the kids has been, well, look, if it does, it does. If it does, it does. And we will return to the property quicker. We will sleep back in our own beds quicker. There might be disruption for a few, there will be disruption for a few months while we get everything sorted. But if it does, it does. It's not the end of the world. You know, we will be in a hotel or an apartment for, you know, a matter of a few weeks, and then we will return. So I think that's very much the message. That does make it easier that we've almost sort of made that commitment that, you know, come what may, that's what will happen.
And you've survived before, you're surviving.
Exactly, you know, exactly, kind of, yes, absolutely.
That's really kind of Selena to have shared her experiences with us. And yeah, I think there's so many fascinating insights that we can take from this, because the property setup, you know, its wall type, its construction material, all these different measures have been factored in when it comes to actually reviewing what property flood resilience measures would be appropriate for their home. And that contextual approach is so important, because, you know, we can't just copy and paste the strategy from one place to another. We need to make sure that these measures are appropriate, not just for the building and the location and the hazard type, but actually for the users themselves and for Selena and her family. You know, they can put those barriers in place. They know how things work. They know how to operate and maintain them over time. And I think that, you know, that joined up approach is really crucial and really a fantastic thing that we can see here. Flood resilient design does not have to be a compromise. It can be a key part of us actually living with this uncertainty, living with residual risk. It's still a beautiful family home. You know, ultimately what these property flood resilience measures are providing is that peace of mind to know actually that they've taken actions, they've got measures in place, and if there is a recovery required, then it can be a lot quicker because they've thought through actually ways that they can make their property more flood recoverable. You know, from the flooring to the walls and actually even to the kitchen design. You know, I think a stainless steel kitchen's beautiful. I mean, it would be at home in a high-end restaurant. It looks fantastic. So again, I think there's a lot that we can learn from this, and it's really inspiring to see. We have also got a 3D tour of this space, which is available to view at hazardandhope.com. If you'd like to find out more about how you can adapt your home to be more flood resilient, then do check out our Flood Fundamentals series, because there's a range of different episodes there that talk about what the code of practice is, and other episodes on how to adapt and design your walls, floors, kitchens and property to be more flood resilient. So thanks very much for listening. And if you yourself have got a property or know of a property that might be relevant to feature within this series, then please do get in touch. And if you'd like to keep updated on future episodes, then subscribe below, hit the bell for notifications, and we'll look forward to seeing you soon.